Sabri, lucky, thanks for joining us at AWS Studio in Mobile World Congress. We are going to have this conversation talking about innovation that we have already done, but innovation that three players like AWS, and Ericsson, we can do together. Let me start just telling us something about E&, and these big changes that E&, is doing from a telco to a tech company.
So Etisalat recently rebranded its name to E&. We operate in 16 countries across Middle East and Africa. We provide telecommunication services and also digital services for both consumer and enterprises.
Okay, thank you. And Lucky, everyone knows Ericsson, but specifically your area. What are you doing in terms of innovation and cloud adoption?
Thanks, Mauro. And thanks for having us here. I head up cloud and software services in Middle East and Africa. And essentially, we're driving ICT solutions across the board, across the BSS, OSS, core network perspective, the ADM, IT services, and everything that operates across the network. We're going through a large period, as you know, with the introduction of 5G and the proliferation of 5G around our market area with great success.
And Sabri, we did the first project together with Ericsson in terms of BSS transformation and moving some BSS workload to the cloud. How do you think that is important for you to have AWS and Ericsson joining forces together in terms of, let me say, being confident that this kind of journey is going in the right direction?
Well, in the past, we deployed a large multitude of back office applications in the cloud, and it worked quite well. It helped us to bring world-class innovation rapidly to our end users. But when it comes to the telecom critical mission applications like the charging system, the product catalog, and the core network, it's very important that we verify and test thoroughly those applications in the cloud. So I think having AWS and Ericsson working together to verify these applications and to industrialize the whole product portfolio is extremely important. So we see it quite positive, and it serves telecom service providers like Etisalat or E&, quite well.
And Lucky, from your point of view, how is it important to Ericsson on the cloud services to have a very, very strong relationship with AWS, joining forces to provide the best solution for our customers?
We're firm believers in open architecture and infrastructure, very much that each of the service providers and the ecosystem players are going to need flexibility in the options that are made available when it comes to infrastructure. Many, many various benefits from doing that. So it's super important that we can work with infrastructure providers and services providers like AWS so that we can address E&'s international OPCO requirements, time to market, flexibility, and coverage. Coverage in terms of the speed at which we can move the software development lifecycle, the testing lifecycle, and at the end of the day, we really want to make end consumers provision those services, use those services, and benefit from those services as soon as we can. So it's immensely important.
Sabri, as you said, Etisalat is a big group covering 16 different countries around Middle East and Africa. And for sure, it's not easy to have the same strategy and the same execution across all the entire group. So what is the approach that you are using to have a solution that doesn't fit for all the opcos, but will allow to the group to maintain one strategy across the group?
Yes. Well, we've decided to adopt a hybrid multi-cloud architecture and to partner with players like AWS, where you can provide different architecture to fit different demands. So like the outpost, the local zone, and the region. So in the areas where we have a requirement to comply to certain data sovereignty, outpost is one of the architecture that we've recommended for our international opcos. And also have the zone and the region. As you're aware, in UAE, we've implemented the region architecture, while local zone is being explored in other places. Yeah.
Thank you. And Lucky, talking about the regulation and data sovereignty, we know is one of the biggest obstacles that we have in terms of cloud adoption. And we need to find the right balance between the regulation and the security that each country is requesting and the innovation that is driving it to move to the cloud. How do you think that is the synthesis between these two factors in terms of balancing the security and allowing the innovation to go through?
You know, we're a firm believer, again, in the multi-hybrid cloud concept. And essentially, the synthesis will come from the flexibility in the options that we can give service providers. The synthesis comes in the understanding of the data sovereignty requirements. That's why we believe there's always going to be some type of instance of on-premises, and there'll always be some type of instance of distributing the compute storage throughout the network as well. And the opportunity to work with industry players like AWS and EAND gives us the ability to prove that it does work, that we can cater for regulatory requirements around secure data, securing that potentially subscriber data doesn't move across borders, but then data that's not so requirement from a secure perspective, then we can handle that in the right way as well. And I think in Egypt, we did a great proof point in that, that we could actually also take certain workloads that maybe they weren't online requirements. Maybe we could process offline, or maybe latency wasn't the key requirement. So we could prove that in a particular way using VPN, et cetera. So for us, the synthesis comes from the options that we can give service providers in that sense.
And in Egypt, we started with the dev test.
Yes.
So there were no any restriction to verify the concept.
Exactly.
Yeah, so yeah. And product catalog as well, as you know.
Yeah. Yeah. We started with test and dev. That was, let me say, a safe environment without any, let me say, effect, direct effect in terms of regulation. Where do you think that, again, being compliant with the regulation, we can move forward in terms of BSS transformation to the cloud? And when do you think that we should stop because we are going against the law and the regulations?
Yeah. I mean, basically, we've decided just to divide the BSS landscape into different layers. So for back office application, especially in the modules where we don't have any sensitive data, the idea is to move to the cloud to benefit from all the advanced features and the continuous development and enhancements. In the area where we have the CRM, I call it the industry generic application, like the CRM analytics, e-commerce, we have the hybrid architecture in which the engine, the logic, can be in the cloud, wherever it is. But when it comes to customer data, it will be on-prem if the regulation requires it. And then we have the telecom-specific application, like the charging and so on, in which the requirement here is not only the being compliant, but also ensuring the performance and availability. And for that one, the current partnership between AWS and Ericsson is very helpful to verify those applications and gradually to move it to the cloud. But some application will continue to be on-prem due to stringent performance requirements. Yeah. So I think it's a journey. It needs to be gradual. And I think the rules and the law would need to evolve.
I think to Sabri's point as well, it's not just a regulatory consideration, but very much also performance, certain workloads you want to run on premises for different reasons, but also resilience. You want to be able to have resiliency options or redundancy options that give you flexibility also in how you recover and manipulate the solution to cater for the local environment. So, you know, I think those three together, the regulatory, the resilience, and the performance, are absolutely key on where you want to place the workloads.
And even the cloud is becoming more distributed, yes. So you have the central cloud, then you have the private, the edge, the far edge. So I think the technology is evolving.
It's evolving, and
it will help also to cater for the performance requirement and for the regulatory at the same time.
Where in 2 years from now you would like to see this collaboration between AWS and Ericsson, let me say, landing in terms of the journey to the cloud for you?
I think the POC that we run in Egypt, it was a good starting point. We start with the product catalog and also the dev test. I think in the next 2 years, we would like to see other elements within the Ericsson BSS moving or having the option to be on-prem or in the cloud. And I think that can evolve also to include core or and the packet core in the future. Yeah. And maybe part of the radio access.
And Lucky, what do you expect from a partner like AWS, let me say, to evolve this partnership in the next few years? What should we do, or what should we do better than today in terms of partnership?
Well, I think we've already started on a good footing. So let's just say that this was a great proof point that when we collaborate together, we can prove that the technology can evolve, and it can give operators like EN and the entire group options. At the end of the day, this is what we're trying to provide, business options. What we're expecting is the same spirit to help us to evolve our solutions. Ericsson's very much a believer, I said before, in the multi-hybrid cloud concept. But we also write all of our solutions, all of our software, to work on any infrastructure. In that sense, the wealth of knowledge and experience that AWS has in those deployments is absolutely crucial for us to also learn and to be able to cater for those as we go through to customer environments. That customer experience and the learning that you can get from different deployments, but also the considerations we talked about earlier, the resiliency, the performance, the security. If we're evolving together, if we're evolving for specific requirements, I mean, UAE has one particular requirement, that Egypt is different, and then various other countries around the region are also having different considerations. And I think when we work together, we work far more effectively to address those.
And we should be able, let me say, to localize and to globalize only localizing, correct?
Yeah.
So we cannot address the entire group just with one single approach, but we need to identify what are the specific requirements.
And to have an extensible architecture that can cater for different needs.
That's a great point. Scaling our success is important. So I know Ian and Sabri, you are very keen to say, if we can prove something in Egypt also, how can you utilize it across the rest of the operating companies? It's the same with our partnership with AWS. We love to see where else we can scale these solutions in a cost-effective, go-to-market effective manner as well. So I think it's great that we industrialize that experience. And I talk about industrialization because that's really when we're being able to give the market real true benefit in that sense.
So, Sabri, we started the journey in terms of innovation with the project in Egypt, and there is something that we did in terms of innovation and something that probably we should do in the next months and years. What do you consider that was the biggest innovation that we implemented on this project, and what do you expect that is going to happen in the future?
Yeah, the main thing that we did is we deployed the Ericsson product catalog in AWS public cloud, basically. And this helped the, it's a POC that we did. So basically it helped to create more innovative service offering, bundling telecom and non-telecom services. And also it shortened the time to market. And it provides enhanced operational efficiency as well. So that's what we did so far as a POC. And we would like to extend that to include other elements of within the Ericsson BSS portfolio.
Yeah. I think together we took a lot of learnings out of that proof of concept. And when it comes to time to market, we reduced it by 65%, as you recall. And then from a total cost of ownership perspective, I think EN was reporting 16% reduction. And that's just on the deployment that we made. We saw that the benefits were there, they could be realized. We catered for the security requirements via VPN usage. We knew that there wasn't secure data that was being transferred. There was a particular piece that we were proving So from that perspective, we also start to understand the regulations far deeper and how we can cater for that as well. I think it's safe to say that we took a lot of learnings also around how we set up.
So how we created the setup, yeah.
Yeah, as a partnership, it worked really effectively. But to get it going, it's very different than the traditional partnerships that we've had before. I think just signing the agreements took longer than the actual proof of concept itself. In that sense, it leads to, you know, how we should cooperate in the future.
And the same setup can be reused to verify other capabilities as well.
Yes. Yeah, also the contractual party is part of the long journey that we are starting and where we are learning. So thanks a lot for joining us. Last few words about what is the biggest learning that everyone should take in account in terms of cloud adoption. Just a few words on this.
Yeah, I think working very closely as partners is extremely important. And also the experimentation, trying different things. And to us, at least, the benefit of cloud became much more clearer to our opco, having elastic infrastructure, providing the tools for the developers to create new offering rapidly. And also we trained some of the software developers, and they're going through the certification process within AWS.
For us, we realized very clearly it is a paradigm shift, not necessarily just isolated to the technology, but also how we collaborate. I mentioned earlier around the contracting, but it's also how you set up for that complexity, how you work through each of those challenges. And I think this is a great example of, you know, a partnership that really can realize benefits. So we're really looking forward to the future.
So thanks, Sabri. Thanks, Lucky. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.